Welcome to everyone, especially those who arrived a little later and didn't hear the welcome at the beginning of the service. We have just commenced then a series called From Corinth to Colombo, a sermon series on how First Corinthians, Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, can apply to life today. So I want to encourage you to consider being here every Sunday, like a prayer. Every Sunday at 5 p.m. we will start sharp at 5. And we will use the service to adore God, and we will also use this gathering to encourage and edify one another. And to make sure your sermons don't go blowing in the wind. But it's such a joy for us to begin now, and I want to give you a brief introduction to the whole correspondence that Paul had with the Corinthians. You know, the Corinthians were a city in ancient Greece. Paul wrote a number of letters. The New Testament has 27 books, as we know, of which 13 are letters written by the Apostle Paul. And among these are two letters that he writes to these people called the Christians in Corinth. Now, the church had been started by Paul around 50 AD. 50 years after the birth of Christ, Paul visited Corinth on his second missionary journey, and then he began this church. The last time I stood here, I think my mask was falling. This time my sermon is trying to run away. But he began this church against a lot of opposition. And there were people who opposed him from the Jews, and he also had difficulties with the Roman governor and so on. But he continued this work, and he saw that this was something that was very important to Christ, because Jesus himself appeared to Paul in Acts 18 and said, "Saul, I have many people here. Continue the work that you're doing." So he did it for 18 months, 1.5 years, one of the longest periods that Paul worked in a particular city. Now, Corinth was a modern city of the ancient Roman world. It had all the facilities and amenities of modernity: temples, stadiums, harbors and markets, wealthy homes, government buildings and cultural centers. Every 2 years, Corinth was the host of what was called the Isthmian Games. It was second only to the Olympic Games and was held every 2 years. And so many people from around the Roman world would come for the Isthmian Games. And Corinth therefore became a place where there were a lot of travel, a lot of people coming in and spending their money in Corinth. Because it had two harbors, it was also one of those places where a lot of ships came through, and so economy boomed. But Corinth was also quite unusual. It had been destroyed about 150 years before Christ by the Romans, and then was completely abandoned for 100 years. Corinth was just an abandoned place from 144 BC until about 44 BC, when Julius Caesar decided to repopulate Corinth. But how do you repopulate an abandoned place? He found that he could kill two birds with one stone. He needed Corinth repopulated, and he had a lot of people in Rome that were slaves who had been set free. And these freed slaves were too many in Rome. They were a problem for Julius Caesar. So he decided to send them off to Corinth so that they can establish themselves there. And so these were all freed slaves, most of them, who were able to rebuild Corinth and build up the economy. But they carried with them a little chip on their shoulder, because they were not of wealthy homes, they were not from an ancestry that they could be proud of, they were slaves who had been freed. Now, two things are very apparent from the historical and archaeological record of the ancient city of Corinth. One is that they were very religious, and so the excavations in Corinth show a number of temples and shrines all over the place, near each other. Obviously, Corinth was a very religious city. In fact, it had a temple to the goddess Aphrodite. It had other Roman and Greek temples, shrines. And this was very important to the Corinthians. Idolatry was very prominent in Corinth. But there was also something that was very, very prominent in Corinth, and that was sexual immorality, fornication. In fact, an ancient writer coins a word to talk about fornication. He says to fornicate is to Corinthianize, because they were so synonymous with sexual immorality. And the temple of Aphrodite, said one historian, one writer, probably a little exaggerating, he said that there were 1,000 temple prostitutes in the temple of Aphrodite. And so with the ships coming in from two harbors and with so many people coming in from outside, it became the place to go. It was the red light district of the Roman world. Now the church in Corinth was founded by Paul. 18 months later he left. But the church in Corinth after that gradually lost their friendship with Paul. They began to be influenced by others. And remember, they were carrying a chip on their shoulder. And so when they met other preachers who came through, especially Apollos, who was a more fluent and eloquent preacher than Paul, well-versed in the Greek scriptures and Greek texts and Greek literature, when they listened to Apollos, he was like coming from Oxford. And it felt like Paul had come from a very low university. And so they began to compare these leaders, and they felt maybe Paul wasn't as great as they once thought. Also, Paul wasn't like a typical philosopher of the day. You know, the philosophers of that day, they liked to just move from city to city. And they believed that it was not right for philosophers to be involved in mundane things like doing jobs and working with their hands. But Paul insisted on working. And he looked like an ordinary person, not a real Christian leader who should be walking in, someone should be carrying his bag, and this was not Paul. They didn't like the image that Paul carried. And so they gradually drifted away from him, and they began to consider other leaders. But because they lost their closeness to Paul, they also became vulnerable to fall back into their old social and cultural practices. You see, they were not listening to their spiritual father anymore. And so before long, the church in Corinth saw a massive shift in their moral and ethical behavior of all her members and fell into conflict and sexual misconduct. During our series, we will read in chapter 5 about a man who was now keeping his father's wife, that is his stepmother, as his own partner. So it was quite remarkable that in the church, all this kind of immorality and divisions were flourishing. So Paul wrote them a letter. In chapter 5 and verse 9, Paul mentions, "I wrote you a previous letter." And he tried to warn them and tell them, don't be like this. But it didn't go down very well. They got very upset with Paul. And Paul was hurt by how they responded. But now he's in Ephesus. And some people from Chloe's household, Romy read that for us. Some people from a rich lady's household from Corinth have come to visit Paul. And they have given Paul a earful. They have said, Paul, things are really bad in Corinth. There's a guy coming into church with his father's wife. And everybody is quite cool. They are still singing praise the Lord. While all these crazy things are happening in the church. And people are making up all kinds of groups in church. And they're fighting with each other. And the leader's meeting is becoming quite unbecoming of a leader's meeting. And so Paul has to respond to some of these problems. But he's also, he has received a letter from three men called Stephanus, Fortunatus, and Achaicus. In chapter 16 and verse 17, we are told that a letter has been sent by the Corinthians asking Paul a lot of questions and somewhat criticizing Paul or speaking a little in a way that challenges Paul. And so in the letter of the Corinthians, Paul is responding both to the reports from Chloe's household and to the letter that the Corinthians had written to him. And so we can see the structure of 1 Corinthians. Today we look at the introduction, and then we begin Paul's response to all those things that people had said from Chloe's household. And that will go on till chapter 6 and verse 20. But from chapter 7 and verse 1, Paul will begin to respond to the letter that they had written with lots of questions. So please bring your Bible when you come to church from next Sunday. It's very difficult with a phone Bible to follow all the things that are going on in the scriptures. So please bring that, and then that should be chapter 16, verse 14 to 24, is the concluding section of 1 Corinthians.